Minecraft is not an 8-bit game. Neither is this or this. Games like Super Mario and Pac-Man were designed for systems that had 8-bit processors, meaning that these processors deal with data in units of 8 bits as opposed to today's 64-bit processors. Their iconic pixel art wasn't a stylistic choice, but was a result of hardware limitations in rendering graphics. But could a modern game like Minecraft ever run on one of these old processors from the 80s? Well, no. Rendering a complex 3D environment is simply too much for these machines to handle, but I think I can create something similar without resorting to going full 2D. But there are plenty of reasons no one has ever attempted to do this yet. If I were to turn Minecraft into an NES game, I'd be limited to a Ricoh 2A03 running at 1.79 MHz with 2 kilobytes of onboard RAM, a 26x240 video output, and 2 kilobytes of cartridge storage. For context, this picture of a giraffe is 4.22 MB. But there is a better option. The newly released Commander X16 has a similar 8-bit processor, a 65C02, but it runs at 8 MHz, has 512 kilobytes of onboard RAM, displays a 640x480 output, and has an SD card for data storage. But while this is a powerful 8-bit computer, it's still nowhere close to being capable of running Minecraft, meaning that I'll have to program everything in 6502 assembly with no rendering engines and no libraries. First, let's break down how this is going to work from the blocks up. Just like regular Minecraft, the world will be broken into 16x16 chunks, but because of limited memory, I have to cap the build limit at 16. Still, that's 4096 blocks per chunk. Each block is a piece of data that has two attributes, the block's state and type. Since there are a lot of blocks in Minecraft, I settled on using 1 bit for state to keep track of things like is the wheat grown or not, and 7 bits for type, giving 128 possible block types, making each block exactly 1 byte long and a chunk 4 kilobytes. One squeeze of the old Python later and now I have a bunch of basic chunks that can function as a test world. Notice how each chunk is a separate file in the world folder. This is because the X16 doesn't like loading only part of a file. It only wants the whole thing or nothing at all. Not very socialist of it, but that's alright since only a few chunks will ever be loaded in at once. Let's talk graphics now. The X16's video controller, the Vera, has two modes. Tile mode, like the NES where the background is broken into 8x8 tiles, and bitmap mode, like modern systems where each pixel is defined individually. Similar to the NES, it has two separate graphics layers, but the X16 also sports a total of 128 hardware sprites, double that of the NES. That's a lot of graphics. But the biggest limit here is video RAM. I can't even produce a single 640x480 bitmap without running out of VRAM, let alone try to include the graphical data for 128 blocks, 128 items, and the sprite data. So to save memory, I can use tile mode instead, and reduce the block tiles from using 256 colors at 8 bits per pixel to 16 colors at 4 bits per pixel, which shouldn't be a problem since Minecraft blocks are usually pretty one note. Using tiles, the viewing angle is going to be a little strange. Each block will be represented by 6 tiles, 4 for the top and 2 for the front, like we're looking at the blocks head-on from a 67.5 degree angle, giving our chunks a kind of endearing squished look. I can also get away with using less VRAM by shrinking the X16's viewport from 640x480 to either the Game Boy size 160x120 or 3DS size 320x240, with the latter showing more of the chunk, so that's what I decided to go with. I'll keep layer 0 for displaying the world, and layer 1 for the HUD and crafting stuff, and then I can keep the player and mob sprites settled in between the two layers. But before I can process my chunk data into something we can see, I first have to create the block tile data. At 4BPP, each pixel in the block is represented by 4 bits, being a number from 0 to 15. This tells the Vera which column of the X16's 256 color palette to use, while the row number is set by a separate sprite in the layer tile map. This is the default X16 color palette, but I can replace it with my own custom palette. I took every single Minecraft block texture and threw it in a program to analyze the color of each pixel, and then rank how often they occur and give me the 256 most common colors. This is the Minecraft palette. And honestly, it's kind of ugly. Even a few tweaks of what gets counted didn't really help improve it. So I decided instead to just replace old colors with new colors as needed as I draw these block tiles. But unlike designing tiles for the NES, which thanks to programs like YYCHR is as easy as winning the claw game in Kirby, the X16 doesn't have any such tools. So I made them myself. This is my X16 4BPP tile editor. You can create a tile sheet as large as you like, then choose which tile you'd like to edit, and then from a range of tools you can draw your 8x8 tile, with automatic color display changes for palette index selection, custom palette editing by right-clicking the color you want to change, direct export and import from binary data, and best of all, I can spam Control S as much as I like, as everything is also backed up locally in the browser. Honestly, one of the best parts of being a programmer is being able to make your own tools to do the things you need to do. So I use my tile editor to draw all this. Yeah, it's not every block I planned on, and it doesn't look great. So let's please just get to the programming. I can now take my folder of chunks and then load 9 chunk files into the computer's RAM, and then convert it into graphical data. While the 65CO2 16-bit address bus allows it to access 2 to the power of 16 or 65,536 unique memory addresses, the system memory map reveals it only has access to around 36 kilobytes of free memory and lower RAM, barely enough for 9 chunks, and that's without considering any program code stored here as well. But the space between these two memory addresses allows access to an 8K RAM bank. This means that by setting a certain value, I can tell the X16 which of the 256 RAM banks my kitted out machine has that I want placed in this memory area, allowing the CPU access to 2 megabytes of total RAM. With this in mind, I can place each 4 kilobyte chunk into a different RAM bank. Then when the player reaches the point where they need to load in new chunks, I can swap in 3 new chunks in the banks where the 3 old ones were. And as long as I don't get my pointers crossed, it should all flow perfectly fine. Now to process this chunk, I have to convert the list of 4096 block types to a list of tile numbers to copy to the layer 0 tile map in VRAM. With blocks measuring 16 by 24, a chunk covers a 256 by 384 area. That's 32 by 48 tiles. And since each tile in the map is defined by 2 bytes, that's another 3 kilobytes of data that describes how this chunk looks. It would be a huge waste to calculate what it looks like continuously when rendering, since it doesn't really change. So once I load the chunk in the memory, I can process it and then store the graphical data in the second half of the chunk's RAM bank. That way it's accessible when I need it to be stitched together with the other chunks in the map. As for the chunk rendering algorithm, my first thought was to go from the top left corner across the row, and then continue to the next row and the next, and then after that layer, go to the one below that, and so on. But without reading the current state of the tiles, rendering this way will overwrite blocks on the top. Instead, if I start from the bottom layer and then proceed to draw every block, I still do a bit of overwriting, but it saves having to read the state of every tile over and over, so it winds up being faster. Now, that's the abridged process I eventually came up with. In reality, it was a couple hard days of hitting the keys to go from this, to this, to this, to this. 9 chunks completely rendered. But there are still a few problems with scrolling the chunks, and things are literally coming along slowly. It turns out that handling vast amounts of data, like 9 chunks worth of graphical data, is CPU intensive. So when it comes to shifting the chunks over in VRAM, it has a hard time doing it fast enough, which results in some graphical errors, especially since I'm not editing the VRAM directly, but through registers. The solution I came up with was twofold. One, to create a VRAM buffer in lower RAM so that I can modify the graphical data in the CPU's directly accessible RAM and then quickly copy this over through the proper registers to store it in video RAM when it's ready. And two, I now only render the small section right around where the player will be. It's honestly a waste of processing power to render the outer edges, even on a buffer. So I cut all that out and only worry about what's actually visible. And with that, walking around and even walking into newly loaded chunks is working. But from experimenting with different block layouts and trying to add in hills and such, I ran into another problem. I don't like how it looks. If you're looking at something straight on in Minecraft, you can still tell different blocks apart because from your perspective, you can see the sides of other blocks. My model is what happens if your view was moved a sufficient distance away until the edges were no longer visible. And beyond that, there's another problem with static tiles in that things at different elevations all look the same. You can't tell which layers are which since the tiles all blend together. On top of that, due to block shape, stacked blocks look especially strange, to the point where this terrain with hills and valleys looks like a complete mess. I should have seen this coming earlier. I should have done more mockups. I should have done more testing before spending, maybe even wasting, my days programming this. But it's only a waste if I give up. Already I've built a great chunk loading engine and a competent tile maker. All I need to change is how the game is rendered. I could embrace 2D and flatten everything out, doing something that would look similar to The Legend of Zelda. I could have trees and stuff in the overworld and have blocks placed all around. The downside is that that would remove a whole axis of movement, but it would be much easier to program. But instead I'm going to go full axonometric. Think games like Q-Bert, Marble Madness, 3D Ant Attack. These games are tilted at an isometric viewing angle that give a 3D perspective. But if I'm going to implement isometric blocks, then I can't do it using tile mode, because multiple blocks overlap the same tile. So I either have to create thousands of tile combinations for the 128 different blocks, or I go into bitmap mode. As mentioned before, bitmap mode defines the color of each and every pixel on the screen, meaning that bitmaps take up much more video memory than their tiled counterparts, and that's without considering that I would have to change to 8-bit per pixel coloring to achieve the same color diversity as before, which would also increase the size of the block graphic data as well. So I did some serious number crunching. For hours I sat there designing models, trying to reduce the memory footprint. I reduced the block size from 16 pixels to 12, to 8, to 4, to 2, and then back to 8. Screen size had to be reduced from 3DS to Game Boy, both to reduce the memory required and zoom in on the new, smaller blocks. I'm going to be using a system of pseudo-tiles for chunk rendering. Essentially, for each block in the chunk, I find the on-screen bitmap coordinates and then run a subroutine that draws an 8x8 block on the screen. Doing it this way, I can store the block graphic data as if it were an 8x8 tile sheet, meaning that after a relatively quick update to my tile maker to allow for 8BPP tile designing, I produced even more blocks than I had before. Of course, being only 1/6 the size and with minimal details also helped speed up that process. With my prior experience in chunk rendering, programming a robust chunk loader this time went much smoother, mostly. And because I knew what I was expecting in regards to rendering 9 chunks at a time, I made sure that it would take a minimal effort to go from one chunk, to many, to all 9 chunks. And this isometric view makes it so much easier to distinguish the X, Y, and Z coordinates of each block. But speed-wise, if scrolling tiles in the old version was moving at snail pace, then scrolling the bitmap is glacial. And while there isn't a great way to optimize this without sacrificing huge swaths of video memory, there is a solution. And to help explain, here for the first time, ladies and mostly gentlemen, please give it up for Stanley, everybody! Stanley, please show us how this is going to work. Breaking it down, there's a ring around the central chunk, and a single pixel is being tracked at Stanley's foot. Whenever this pixel hits the ring, it triggers a shift into an adjacent chunk, and reloads the screen accordingly. This process recycles most of the code that I wrote before, meaning that nothing turned out to be a real waste. Now, I'm not done yet. I haven't even reached the alpha stage of this project, but I want some feedback from you. What do you want to see in this 8-bit mining game? And if you want to see how this game is updated next, then hit that subscribe button, and I'll see you with another update real soon.